There we go. Can you hear me? Okay, Dar, good to see you, man. Can you hear me okay, Dave? Not saying much at the moment. Okay. Just gonna let you know, I haven't forgotten you. Well, I'll explain later, but I hadn't forgotten you, buddy. What's been going on? Anything? Oh well, thanks. Hatchet fish. Well, for watching, hey folks, y'all come on in, sit down. We haven't got a particular topic tonight. I know the news has been busy and the chat rooms have been busy and stuff, so I figure we'll probably have plenty to talk about. You guys come on in and get your requests in, I suppose, and we'll go where you guys want to go. God's good. Jesus is amazing. And things happen often that reinforce my will to serve him. The God we follow is good and powerful, and he's good. I was at the not many folks here, so I'll just go ahead and tell you, I was at the shop today, and one of the older guys up there, he's over 80, and he works at least half a day most of the time. Good guy, but he showed me a little thing on his phone, and I'll synopsize. It was basically, and you may have seen it, but basically a woman in need. Her husband was ill, and she had 7 children to feed, and she was humbly trying to convince the store manager to let her purchase some staples on credit, and he wouldn't. Oh, I'm not worried about it. I like I said, I'll explain later. he was wanting to buy groceries on credit, and he wouldn't let her. And he was rather cold about it. And another customer overheard and offered to buy what she needed. And I guess maybe faced with the prospect of looking bad, the store owner said, "Well, tell you what," asked her, said, "Do you have a grocery list?" And she said she did. And he said, "Well, he had one of those old balance scales. I don't know when this supposedly happened, but anyway, he told her to put the list on the scale, and he'd give her that much in groceries." And you know, she was embarrassed and all, and she took her little piece of paper out and put it on the scale, and the scale went down as if it were weighted, and the other customer and the manager started putting groceries on the scale, and it didn't move, it didn't lift, and finally the scales wouldn't hold anymore. And the guy honored his what he said, and he gave her the groceries. She left, and they picked up the list. It wasn't a list at all. And let me see if I can find it. Yeah, it's basically out of like Matthew 6:8, and basically it was a prayer, and it said, "Father, you know my needs before I pray," and she's leaving this in His hands, and like I said, that's a good and powerful God that we serve. And you know, I hear these things all the time, and I heard someone say, "Hey, Janet, good to see you." I heard someone say today, they said, "God works in mysterious ways." And I stopped them and I said, "No, He works." Hey, Cap. Good to see you, brother. But yeah, when I was a little bitty kid, little bitty fella, my grandmother took me to see a house where a storm had come by. It was near here. This enormous... Yeah, he's been working a lot, Janet. I expect him to be in here this evening, hopefully. She took me to see this house, and this enormous tree had fallen on it. And the tree, you know, fell completely over on the house and broke part of the roof, but then it just stopped. And my grandmother carried us to make us, you know, check it, let us check it out. And the most remarkable thing was is the next portion of the roof to break was just above the sleeping baby. And yeah, I guess I'll remember that all my life. I don't know what was holding that tree to this day. We got bad video output this evening. The web's probably busy. There's a lot going on. I think it's been that way pretty much most of the week. Hope everybody's doing well. We're about 7:07. We'll give them a couple more minutes, and then we'll say a prayer and talk about whatever you guys want to talk about. No, the weather's pretty nice here, Janet. I've actually got the window open, and it's warm. But there's getting storms everywhere, and you know, with all the breaking news and stuff going on, I expect that's why the web is quite busy. How you been feeling, Janet? How's your hip? I bet it's brand new, ain't it? I hope. Wow. Man, I'm sorry. That's that Canada weather, I guess. Catch, have you been checking out the new Corner Gas? Like I said, it's animated, but it's still pretty cute, and it's got all the same people doing the voices and stuff, so it's pretty good. Okay, Janet. Well, take it easy. Don't overdo it. You know, it's going to take a little longer to heal than all natural tissue, but take care of yourself, and I think and hope that your pain is gone. So good. We'll continue to pray for you. I'm quite sure you're still on the list here. Yes, ma'am. I just checked, and you're still on the list. Well, you give him a little leeway. Like I said, don't hurt yourself. We want you to heal fully, and everything will be good. Well, I'd say it's about 7:10, so we'll go ahead and and have a prayer. What? Oh yeah, Corner Gas. Oh, I watch it on a website called Dare TV Catch, and well, it doesn't cost anything, Janet, and if we pray for you, it doesn't take away from anyone else. God's mercy is abundant. I've been watching it on Dare TV Catch, and I'm kind of set up to watch there. You have to go there and try it because it's eat up with ads and stuff, and you kind of got to be a little bit defensive, but it works good once you get the hang of it. But it's the links are on Dare TV. You're welcome, Janet. okay, well, let's go ahead and say a prayer, and then, like I said, we'll yes, sir, Dare TV. That's right. Just search Dare TV, and it'll come up. So it'll come up like My Dare Watch or something like that, but that's it. You'll find it. All right. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. May your kingdom come and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Please forgive us our sins as we forgive those that sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory. Father, we're so grateful to have this group to fellowship with and learn with. We're so grateful for this Sabbath day that you've set aside for us to make time to be with our Heavenly Father and to learn about Him and His magnificent Son, Yeshua, Jesus the Christ. Father, we love you. We're so grateful. Please be with us as we study your word. And in Yeshua's precious name we pray. Amen. Well, what's on you guys' minds? Anything in particular? I was trying to think of a really good story, but like I said, I'd really rather go where you guys want to go. Request line is open. This jacket fits me kind of funny. I look frumpy on camera. This is a standing jacket, not a sitting jacket. Well, you guys, come on, somebody say something. Well, like I said, I don't know. What's somebody's favorite story? Well, we'll take a look at their favorite Bible story. You know, Janet, that's something I have pondered at great length. And, you know, honey, I kind of hope so because I got two kids that... don't even talk to me. I don't. Anyway. But you know, as far as I know, they're not believers. I'm sure their mothers convinced them of all kind of things, including my insanity. You know, the possibility is there, Janet. You know, from my understanding of reading the scriptures that you're talking about. You know, the possibility is there, well, you know, unfortunately, you know, my personal fears are, you know, we take a look at, hey, Bri, we take a look at the Israelites in the wilderness, and you know, when God would send manna down for them, all the able-bodied had to collect their own manna. I couldn't collect yours, you couldn't collect mine. It didn't work that way, and it's hey Namo, good to see you, and it's the same with our relationship with Christ. You know, nobody can collect your manna, and you can't collect it for anyone else. And it's an interesting point, Janet, and I wish I could give you the answer that I know you want, and it's the same one that I want too. But I'm unsure, to be perfectly honest, you know. Just keep praying, honey. That's the best advice I have. I know he hears us, and I know he loves us. And you know, those that I love, I like to do things for, and I have a feeling that I didn't come about that emotion or that feeling on my own. It was given to me by God, and so I think that He feels a lot of the same things that we feel, and we know He doesn't want anyone to perish. So keep praying. I hope that's half of enough of an answer. I know it's not exactly what you want, but I know exactly where you're coming from. And Brycap, God bless you, brother. You know. Breeze was right, by the way. And it's actually a little more remarkable than you think. We'll talk about it a little later, but anyway. Brycap, what's your favorite Bible story? Amen. Yeah, what's your favorite story? We need a direction to go, and you know, we'll settle on a story, and you guys can ask questions any time, like Janet's question, for example. Just give us something to rattle about while folks ponder. Hey, Appleseed, good to see you. I want to say it's Melissa, I think. Ruth is good. But did we not cover Ruth? Ruth? I said Ruth. Did we not cover Ruth recently? 2 John was talking about the book of Judges. I wonder where he's at. I think he said he had some questions about Judges. But Judges and Ruth, of course, are right there in the same. Yeah, there's John. Hey, John. I started a couple minutes early just to get even, John, because you said I was always late. Yeah, Ruth is good. John, did you have questions about Judges? Judges, you know, leads right into Ruth, and we'll take a look at Ruth. It's a wonderful story, and it's not a long read, so we'll hit it. But like I said earlier today, you mentioned having questions about Judges, and I have my Bible open there, and I can try to help if you have anything particular that. Yeah, TNS has gone nuts. And too, John, I'll read you out of my study Bible the preface part of Judges. It says, covering a period of some hundreds of years from the settlement in Canaan to the establishment of the monarchy under Saul, the book of Judges describes a recurrent pattern among the various Israelite tribes. At first, the people were faithful to the Lord, but they gradually fell into idolatry. Then God punished them through harsh enemies until they repented and called again on the Lord for rescue. And then God raised up some person with authority and charisma, called a judge, to resist and overcome their enemies. The 12 judges described in this book served one or more tribes of Israel in this capacity. Some of them may have served at the same time. Among these judges were such persons as Ehud, Deborah, Gideon, Jephthah, Samson. The pattern of the book of Judges, falling away, punishment, deliverance, is very useful in understanding God's way. Christians can observe similar patterns recurring in the history of the church. Hey, Honeybee, good to see you. And we're just settling on a subject, honey. Right now, the consensus is leaning towards the book of Ruth, which is a beautiful story. And okay, Bri, you take care of yourself, and we'll be here. There's a lot of analog for the plan given in Ruth. Yeah, John. Yeah, and too, that's, what I was going to tell you earlier this morning, and my phone kept ringing and stuff. But it's what they mentioned here in this preface. Samson was very much the same way, the pattern of falling away, punishment and deliverance. But of course, as we all know, the end of the Samson story as Israel has their Samson option. But anyway, like I said, if you have any other questions, just by any means that just speak up, we'll cover them. Janet says, we can, I'll put it here on the request, Janet, that we make a special request on behalf of your son. Well, on behalf of you, regarding your son. I didn't even see Susan come in. Hey, Susan. Okay, well, anybody that's following along, I'm moving over to the book of Ruth. And we'll take a look at it. Like I said, it's a beautiful story. And there's a lot of parallels that you guys may be aware of, you may not be aware of, but we'll try to take a look at them. And it's amazing and beautiful. I don't know, Guy. I have to do a little research on that myself. To be perfectly honest, the covenant between Abraham and Abimelech, I'm not even sure exactly what their covenant was. I'll have to reread, Guy. I'm sorry. And two, Guy, if it gets slow after a while, remind me, and I'll head back to the front of the book, and we'll check it out. Well, the book of Ruth, and again, I'll read the preface portion from my study Bible. Says this is a short story recording an incident during the period of the Judges. An Israelite family moved from Judah to the land of Moab during a famine. The husband died, the two sons married foreign women. Both sons died, the mother, Naomi, returned to her hometown of Bethlehem. One of her daughters-in-law, Ruth, accompanied Naomi, adopting Israelite faith as her own. Ruth married again, this time to Boaz, a wealthy Israelite, and became the great-grandmother of King David. Besides showing intimate details of life in those times, the book of Ruth demonstrates how a foreigner was absorbed into Israelite life and history, thus prefiguring the Christian gospel by which Gentiles are absorbed into God's church. Ruth is a Gentile in the ancestry of Jesus. That's, yeah, I was thinking that there was a fight and that they'd made a peace covenant, Guy, but like I said, to be fresh on every subject in the Bible is very difficult, and like I said, to be perfectly honest, to give you a good opinion, I need to reread it, and I will. I try to do that. If I promise, I try to stick with it. Well, if I promise, I will stick with it, but if I say I will, I try to do it. But anyway, we'll go ahead and cruise through Ruth, take a look at it, see what you guys think. Like I said, it is an amazing, beautiful story, and there's an analog here as well, and we'll cover that after we read it. Chapter 1 reads, "Now it came to pass in the days when the judges ruled that there was a famine in the land, and a certain man of Bethlehem, Judah, went to sojourn in the country of Moab, he and his wife and his two sons. And there was two Bethlehems in those days. If you'll notice, there's Bethlehem Judah and Bethlehem Ephrathah. And Jesus was born in Bethlehem Ephrathah. It was the smaller of the two. A certain man of Bethlehem Judah went to sojourn in the country of Moab, he and his wife and his two sons. And the name of the man was Elimelech, and the name of his wife, Naomi. in the name of his two sons, Mahlon and Chilion, Ephrathites of Bethlehem, Judah. And they came into the country of Moab and continued there. I assume that means they were from the tribe of Ephraim. And they continued there. And Elimelech's, Naomi's husband died, and she was left, and her two sons. And they took them wives of the women of Moab. The name of the one was Orpah, and the name of the other Ruth, and they dwelled there about 10 years. I heard years ago Oprah Winfrey say that her mother meant to name her after Orpah, but she just spelled it wrong. And Mahlon and Chilion died, also both of them, and the woman was left of her two sons and her husband. Then she arose with her daughters-in-law that she might return from the country of Moab, for she had heard in the country of Moab how the Lord had visited his people in giving them bread. Wherefore she went forth out of the place where she was, and her two daughters-in-law with her, and they went on the way to return unto the land of Judah. And Naomi said unto her two daughters-in-law, Go, return each to her mother's house. The Lord deal kindly with you, as ye have dealt with the dead and with me. The Lord grant you that ye may find rest, each of you, in the house of her husband. Then she kissed them, and they lifted up their voice and wept. And they said unto her, Surely we will return with thee and to thy people. And Naomi said, Turn again, my daughters. Why will ye go with me? Are there yet any more sons in my womb that they may be your husbands? Turn again, my daughters. Go your way, for I am too old to have a husband. If I should say I have hope, if I should have a husband also tonight and should also bear sons. Would ye tarry for them till they were grown? Would ye stay for them from having husbands? Nay, my daughters, for it grieveth me much for your sakes that the hand of the Lord is gone out against me. And they lifted up their voice and wept again. And Orpah kissed her mother-in-law, but Ruth clave unto her. And she said, Behold, thy sister-in-law is gone back unto her people and unto her gods. Return thou after thy sister-in-law. And Ruth said, Entreat me not to leave thee, or to return from following after thee. For whither thou goest, I will go, and where thou lodgest, I will lodge. Thy people shall be my people, and thy God my God. Where thou diest, will I die. There will I be buried. The Lord do so to me, and more also, if aught but death part thee and me. When she saw that she was steadfastly minded to go with her, then she left speaking unto her. So they two went until they came to Bethlehem, and it came to pass, when they were come to Bethlehem, that all the city was moved about them, and they said, Is this Naomi? And she said unto them, Call me not Naomi, call me Mara, for the Almighty hath dealt very bitterly with me. I went out full, and the Lord hath brought me home again empty. Why then call me Naomi, seeing the Lord hath testified against me, and the Almighty hath afflicted me? So Naomi returned, and Ruth the Moabitess, her daughter-in-law, with her, which returned out of the country of Moab, and they came to Bethlehem in the beginning of barley harvest. That would have been in the month just past Abib. And Naomi had a kinsman of her husband's, a mighty man of wealth, and of the family of Elimelech, and his name was Boaz. And Ruth the Moabitess said unto Naomi, Now let me now go to the field and glean ears of corn after him in whose sight I shall find grace. And she said unto her, Go, my daughter. Now, does everybody know about gleaning? And are there any questions about what we just covered? If you'll notice, the scripture makes a note or makes mention that Boaz was of the family of Elimelech. And then it talks about gleaning. In those days, the Israelite law, they would harvest a square or rectangular field in a circular pattern, leaving the corners for the poor, and they would glean there and collect grain. And then Boaz, being in the family of Elimelech, puts him in the position of kinsman redeemer under Israelite law, but we can take a look at that a little bit later on. Okay, and Ruth Moabitess said, Let me go glean ears. After I go, in his sight I shall find grace. And she said unto her, Go, my daughter. And she went and came and gleaned in the field after the reapers, and her hap was to light on part of the field belonging unto Boaz, who was the kindred of Elimelech. And behold, Boaz came from Bethlehem and said unto the reapers, The Lord be with you. And they answered him, The Lord bless thee. Then said Boaz unto his servant that was set over the reapers, Whose damsel is this? And the servant that was set over the reapers answered and said, It is the Moabitish damsel that came back with Naomi out of the country of Moab. And she said, I pray you, let me glean and gather after the reapers among the sheaves. So she came and hath continued even from the morning until now, that she tarried a little in the house. Then said Boaz unto Ruth, Hearest thou not, my daughter? Go not to glean in another field, neither go from hence, but abide here fast by my maidens. Let thine eyes be on the field that they do reap, and go thou after them. Have I not charged the young men that they shall not touch thee? That was a question, that they shall not touch thee. And when thou art athirst, go into the vessels, and drink of that which the young men have drawn. Then she fell on her face, and bowed herself unto the ground, and said unto him, Why have I found grace in thine eyes, that thou should take knowledge of me, seeing that I am a stranger? And Boaz answered and said unto her, It hath fully been shown me all that thou hast done unto thy mother-in-law since the death of thine husband, and how thou hast left thy father and thy mother and the land of thy nativity, and art come unto a people which thou knewest not heretofore. The Lord recompense thy work, and a full reward be given thee of the Lord God of Israel, under whose wings thou art come to trust. Then she said, Let me find favor in thy sight, my Lord, for that thou hast comforted me, and for that thou hast spoken friendly unto thine handmaid, though I be not like unto one of thine handmaidens. And Boaz said unto her, At mealtime, come thou hither, and eat of the bread, and dip thy morsel in the vinegar. And she sat beside the reapers, and he reached her parched corn, and she did eat, and was sufficed, and left. And when she was risen up to glean, Boaz commanded his young men, saying, Let her glean even among the sheaves, and reproach her not. And let fall also some of the handfuls of purpose for her, and leave them, that she may glean them, and rebuke her not. So she gleaned in the field until even, and beat out that she had gleaned, and it was about an ephah of barley, which was a measure, of course. And she took it up and went into the city, and her mother-in-law saw what she had gleaned, and she brought forth and gave to her that she had reserved after she was sufficed. And her mother-in-law said unto her, Where hast thou gleaned today? And where wroughtest thou? Or where did you work? Blessed be he that did take knowledge of thee. And she showed her mother-in-law with whom she had wrought, and said, The man's name with whom I wrought today is Boaz. And Naomi said unto her, Daughter-in-law, blessed be he of the Lord, who hath not left off his kindness to the living and to the dead. And Naomi said unto her, The man is near kin unto us, one of our next kinsmen. And Ruth the Moabitess said, He said unto me also, Thou shalt keep fast by my young men until they have ended all my harvest. And Naomi said unto Ruth, her daughter-in-law, It is good, my daughter, that thou go out with his maidens, that they meet thee not in any other field. So she kept fast by the maidens of Boaz to glean unto the end of the barley harvest and of wheat harvest, and dwelt with her mother-in-law. Any questions? Hey, Gail. We're taking a look at the book of Ruth this evening. And I'm scrolling back to see what I've missed. Anything necessary? Well, we're glad you're here, Gail. And yes, I did speak to Honey a little bit earlier, John. We're really glad that all you first-timers are here, and we hope you come back, and I hope not to bore you guys too badly. Okay. Then Naomi, her mother-in-law, said unto her, My daughter, shall I not seek rest for thee, that it may be well with thee? And now is not Boaz of our kindred, with whose maidens thou wast? Behold, he winnoweth barley tonight in the threshing floor. Wash thyself, therefore, and anoint thee, and put thy raiment upon thee, and get thee down to the floor. But make not thyself known unto the man until he shall have done eating and drinking. And for those of you, if anybody wondering about the winnowing barley, that's the way they would separate the grain from the husk. The husk was the chaff is a lot lighter, and they positioned their threshing floors in places where there was wind, and they'd kind of toss it up in the air and let the wind blow away the chaff, and that was the winnowing of the barley. Anyway, she says, and don't make yourself known to Boaz until he's finished eating and drinking. And it shall be, when he lieth down, that thou shalt mark the place where he shall lie, and thou shalt go in, and uncover his feet, and lay thee down, and he will tell thee what thou shalt do. And she said unto her, all that thou sayest unto me, I will do. And she went down unto the floor, and did according to all that her mother-in-law bade her. When Boaz had eaten and drunk, and his heart was merry, he went to lie down at the end of the heap of corn, and she came softly and uncovered his feet and laid her down. And it came to pass at midnight that the man was afraid and turned himself, and behold, a woman lay at his feet. And he said, who art thou? And she answered, I am Ruth, thy handmaid. Spread therefore thy skirt over thine handmaid, for thou art a near kinsman. And I think that was her way of letting him know that maybe she would like to be married. And he said, blessed be thou of the Lord, my daughter, for thou hast shown more kindness in the latter end than at the beginning, inasmuch thou followest not young men, whether rich or poor. And now, my daughter, fear not. I will do to thee all that thou requirest, for all the city of my people doth know that thou art a virtuous woman. And now it is true that I am thy near kinsman. However, howbeit, there is a kinsman nearer than I. And if you understand that there was a kinsman nearer to them, it falls to him to redeem them. And if he cannot, then the next in the line. Boaz goes on, tarry this night, and it shall be in the morning, that if he will perform unto thee the part of a kinsman, well, let him do the kinsman's part. But if he will not do the part of a kinsman to thee, then will I do the part of a kinsman to thee. As the Lord liveth, lie down until the morning. And she lay at his feet until the morning, and she rose up before one could know another. And he said, let it not be known that a woman came into the floor. Also he said, bring the veil that thou hast upon thee, and hold it. And when she held it, he measured 6 measures of barley, and laid it on her, and she went into the city. And when she came to her mother-in-law, she said, who art thou, my daughter? And she told her all that the man had done to her. And she said, these 6 measures of barley gave he to me, for he said to me, go not empty unto thy mother-in-law. Then said she, sit still, my daughter, until thou know how the matter will fall, for the man will not be in rest until he has finished the thing this day. Amen. Then went Boaz up to the gate, and sat him down there. And behold, the kinsman of whom Boaz spake came by, unto whom he said, ho, such a one, turn aside, sit down here. And he turned aside and sat down. And he took 10 men of the elders of the city, and said, sit ye down here. And they sat down. And he said unto the kinsman, Naomi, that is come again out of the country of Moab, selleth a parcel of land, which was our brother Elimelech's. And I thought to advertise thee, saying, buy it before the inhabitants, and before the elders of my people, if thou wilt redeem it, redeem it. But if thou wilt not redeem it, then tell me, that I may know, for there is none to redeem it besides thee, and I am after thee. And he said, I will redeem it. Then said Boaz, what day thou buyest the field of the hand of Naomi, thou must buy it also of Ruth the Moabitess, the wife of the dead, to raise up the name of the dead upon his inheritance. And the kinsman said, I cannot redeem it for myself, lest I mar mine own inheritance. Redeem thou my right to thyself, for I cannot redeem it. Now this was the manner in former time in Israel concerning redeeming and concerning changing. For to confirm all things, a man plucked off his shoe and gave it to his neighbor, and this was a testimony in Israel. Therefore the kinsman said unto Boaz, buy it for thee. So he drew off his shoe. And Boaz said unto the elders and to all the people, ye are witnesses this day that I have bought all that was Elimelech's,
and all that was Chilion's and Mahlon's of the hand of Naomi. Moreover, Ruth, the Moabitess, wife of Mahlon, have I purchased to be my wife, to raise up the name of the dead upon his inheritance, that the name of the dead be not cut off from among his brethren and from the gate of his place. Ye are witnesses this day. And all the people that were in the gate and the elders said, We are witnesses. The Lord make the woman that is come into thine house like Rachel and like Leah, which too did build the house of Israel. And do thou worthily in Ephratah, and be famous in Bethlehem. And let thy house be like the house of Phares, whom Tamar bare unto Judah, of the seed which the Lord shall give thee of this young woman. So Boaz took Ruth, and she was his wife, and when he went into her, the Lord gave her conception, and she bare a son. And the woman said unto Naomi, Blessed be the Lord, which hath not left thee this day without a kinsman, that his name may be famous in Israel. And he shall be unto thee a restorer of thy life, and a nourisher of thine old age for thy daughter-in-law, which loveth thee, which is better to thee than seven sons, hath borne him. And Naomi took the child, and laid it in her bosom, and became nurse unto it. And the woman, her neighbors, gave it a name, saying, There is a son born to Naomi, and they called his name Obed. He is the father of Jesse, the father of David. Now these are the generations of Phares. Phares begat Hezron, and Hezron begat Ram, and Ram begat Amminadab. Amminadab begat Nahshon, Nahshon begat Salmon, Salmon begat Boaz, Boaz begat Obed, Obed begat Jesse, and Jesse begat David. Amen. And that's the end of the book of Ruth. But analogs or the parallels that I mentioned in this book, if you'll notice, if you look at Boaz as a type of Christ, the kinsman redeemer, Naomi as a type of Israel, and Ruth as a type of the Gentile church. And notice, Ruth, you know, he told her not to glean in another field. That would appear somewhat greedy, and she was a faithful Gentile bride. Now, you put all that together, and you see that the Gentile bride was used to redeem Israel through the kinsman redeemer, or the Goel, as the term for the man would be, and Yeshua, Jesus Christ, is our Goel. Hey, Nathan, it sure is good to see you, brother. I saw you in TNS the other night briefly. I didn't have time to talk, and I sure did want to say hey, and where you been? But I'm glad to see you're here with us this evening. Yeah, it has been a month, and we're glad to see you. So, okay, and the book of Ruth. What do you guys, anybody see something there or have a question about what we just heard? And we missed you too, Nathan. I sure am glad you're here, brother. You know, Nathan, while we've got people here to hear this, I must say that you were instrumental in me beginning to doing this, and you deserve a little credit for that. So thank you. It's been a blessing to me, and hopefully to some of the participants. But it's really good to see you, and thanks for coming. Anybody? What you got? What y'all want to talk about? Thanks, Keeson. Well, I just try to... a lot of people take this seriously, and I want them to understand that that I take it seriously as well. It's tough. Sometimes Gail and you know, yeah, some of them are tough. But just hang in there, kind of sound them out, I guess, and press on. You know, it's amazing the information that you'll get from the Bible if you can remember all of those names and when they recur and talk about them in other books and passages, then it helps and makes more sense. But it is really, really tough to remember them all and even pronounce them all. Yeah. And yeah, like I said, Ruth is a small synopsis of the plan of God. Like I said, you know, he shows us just exactly, you know, how it's to be done. And as you well know, Solomon said, you know, nothing has been done that won't be done again. And, you know, there's nothing new under the sun. And our God is a God of patterns. If
if you could read the 23rd Psalms in Hebrew, you know, we all know it says, He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness. But actually, if you're reading it in Hebrew, it reads more of, He leadeth me in the circles of righteousness, which indicates another pattern. He's a God of patterns, and he's made lots of them for us to understand, and there they are. And yeah, Ruth is one of the more beautiful ones. You know, Susan, I had a very similar experience with my first mother-in-law. I mean, she'd smile at my face and never invite me to Thanksgiving, Christmas, nothing. You know, my children would be invited, my wife would be invited, but not me. But anyway, bless her heart. But yeah, the Book of Ruth is a beautiful, beautiful story. And it's typically read on a particular holiday, and right this minute I'm drawing a blank. But sorry about that, Janet. I'm glad you made it back. But yeah, Ruth is great. It's a good one. And like I said, if somebody's got another favorite story that they'd like to talk about, we can do that. Like I said, we can go just about anywhere in the Bible you guys want to go. And slightly outside the Bible on a couple of things. Yeah, well, sort of, Gail, you know, and that's Jesus alluded to that John was in the spirit of Elijah. And you know, I think that was probably had a lot to do with their missions and their faithfulness, fortitude, you know, about carrying these things out. Yeah, that, like I said, Jesus somewhat alluded that John was coming in in the spirit and power of Elijah. And I read the passage a week or two ago, but there was soldiers back in the day, and they had a dead man with them, and they needed to bury him quickly. And I've always heard and gone by Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, and of course Yeshua is the Son. That seems to be okay. Take care, Keeson. Good to see you. Anyway, back to Elisha got Elijah's mantle, if you know the story, and Elisha was quite a prophet. Anyway, they didn't realize it was his grave. They opened it up and buried this, or were attempted to put this dead soldier in there, but his body touched the feet of Elisha, and he came back to life. And that's in your Bibles. That's pretty cool. Yeah, they're not the same person. John the Baptist was Yeshua Jesus's cousin, and he was only just a few months older than Yeshua Jesus. Elijah was centuries older than Jesus. It's Elijah is likely to be one of the last days witnesses. I've heard Elijah and Moses, Elijah and Enoch, I got to kind of lean toward Elijah and Moses, but that's just my opinion. And that's because Moses appeared at the Transfiguration, and I kind of expect that they were there to witness the Transfiguration, because an eyewitness is not an eyewitness unless he doesn't see something. And so I think that's why Moses and Elijah were there, so they could witness. And then again, also, you know, the two men at the tomb dressed in white, they may have well been the witnesses as well. And you know, I think the scripture leads us to angels, but I've often wondered if, again, they were not the witnesses, so they could be witnesses. At any rate, yeah, and yeah, reincarnation is definitely not the right plan, but yeah. And it seems like I overlooked another question, did I? Oh, and Honeybee's question about baptism. I would go with Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost, Honeybee. You know, it's a symbolic rebirth. That's what the baptism is about. You know, its tradition comes from the mikvah, or the ritual bath that the Israelites would submerge themselves in before. It's a ritual purity before they went on into the to the temple. And you know, people have talked about it before. You know, and I posed the question, you know, why did Jesus get baptized? Because, you know, we all know that he was sinless, and he did not need to repent from his sins. But if you look carefully at the description of his baptism, it also fits the requirements for the ordination of a high priest on the temple. And by that, you know, if the high priest was to be inducted, he would go into the mikvah, he would come out, he would be anointed with oil, and then the sitting priest would say, "This is my son in whom I'm well pleased." And now if you go back and look at Christ's baptism, he was baptized in the water, and then as we all know, the Holy Ghost, which is symbolized by oil and the dove in this particular case, lit on him, and that was his anointing. And then not the priest, but Father God himself said, "This is my son in whom I'm well pleased." And I believe that that was Christ being ordained as our high priest. And there you go. But, yeah, I'd go with Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, I think. You must be talking about Moses, Bri. Well, yes, Mills, well, Gail, the Sabbath begins at sundown tonight. That's about the time that this study group begins. And tomorrow's study group will end just before the end of Sabbath. The Sabbath is the seventh day, and that is Saturday. The order of the days has never changed. And in the old days, as you well know, if you're reading your Bible, they talk about the first day or the second day or the third day. They didn't have names for the days of week. These names are all actually pagan. For example, Monday is Moon Day. Saturday is Saturn's Day. And at any rate, the Sabbath, as the Scripture says, is seventh day. And Christ himself said, "Easier for the heavens and the earth to pass away than one jot or tittle be removed from the law." And since heaven and earth are still here, I think that the seventh-day Sabbath is still valid. Also in the Scriptures, it says, you know, Christ was in the synagogue or the temple, as was his custom, on the seventh day to read. So, yeah, I think that it's the Saturday Sabbath is still valid. Millie, yes, the Vatican and Washington, D.C. are both laid out according to Babylonian magic, and I do think that the whole Roman papacy system, the Roman Catholic Church and the Vatican are part of that Babylon, but we cannot discount what we've got in Washington too, because you have some of the same architecture, and you look at the attributes of the United States. I mean, you know, roughly 70% of the world's pornography emanates from the United States, and you know, that's a dismal figure. One I'm not very proud of, but you know, there's a lot of duality in the Bible, and well, you know, the Statue of Liberty is Ishtar. You know, look into the history of it. The sculptor was trying to raise money to do a statue of Ishtar when this thing came up, and I think that it's just the same plan, and called it Lady Liberty. Like I said, there's a lot of duality in the Bible, and you know, I think that possibly one of them is a physical Babylon and another is a spiritual Babylon, but yes, Janet, I'm afraid so. And two, you know, just that pornography is just one thing. There, as you all well know, there's a lot of bad stuff that has come out of the United States and gone out to the world. And, you know, what we got to try to do is send some good out to overcome it. But, yeah, I'm afraid that the United States is at least a Babylon. Right. Yeah, the eighth, the number eight is in Hebrew is like shemen, something like that. And then the word for oil in Hebrew also is has that same root, and it all falls to eternity. You know, the eight, as you've seen, the symbol of eternity, using an eight and stuff. But yeah, you know, the Holy Spirit and the number eight both are linked by the root, the Hebrew word, the root of the word. Well, yeah, it could well be honeybee. And right, Nathan, eight represents new beginnings. That's correct. That's like, and two, we're talking about the word shemen. If you'll notice on the Feast of Booths or Sukkot, the eighth day is called the last great day, or in Hebrew, Shemini Atzeret. And again, there's the shemen. But yeah, it's new beginnings. And Nathan, as you realize, you know, the eighth millennium, it will be eternity. You know, at the beginning of the eighth millennium. Twice, Mills, you're right. when the Pope resigned, lightning struck the Vatican, and then it struck it again very, very soon after at another interesting time. And also, do you remember when he released those doves or something, and then the crows come and killed him or something? It was just crazy. But yeah, I saw all of that happening, and you know, I thought, you know, this is not just a normal thing. This is God speaking through what's going on. It's amazing. Yes, indeed. So, yeah, where are we going from there, guys? Honey, I know that you're new to us. I don't know if you're new to studying the Bible, but it's all so inextricably linked and woven together. It's just absolutely stunning when you know, you start to see these things. It's just amazing. And like I said, you know, the Bible, it's 66 books written by 40 different men that didn't know each other over a period of about 1,500 years. None of them knew about the others. They, you know, it wasn't a collusion. And something else I want you guys to bear in mind: Jesus never taught from the New Testament. Jesus was living the New Testament. He never taught from the New Testament. Jesus taught from the Old Testament because it's what was available. We've talked about that before. The Bible he would have been familiar with was the Septuagint, and I have a copy here, and it's quite interesting. But and do you have a good Bible, honey? Yeah. Well, you know, too, Nathan, there's a couple other scriptures that lead me to believe that it's at least somewhat important. And I'm going to read one of them for you now. It's one I like to call the perfect vision passage, because it's Ezekiel 20:20, but actually I'm going to read 19 and 20, and you may have heard me read it before, but Ezekiel chapter 20 verse 19 says,
I am the Lord your God, walk in my statutes, and keep my judgments, and do them, and hallow my Sabbaths, and they shall be a sign between me and you, that you may know that I am the Lord your God. And if there's ever been anybody that wanted a sign between them and anybody else, I want a sign between me and God. Amen. And there's quite a few people that don't agree with me, and that's okay. But I want you to know, and some of the others that keep a Saturday Sabbath will understand, it is probably the hardest commandment to keep. If you start keeping the Saturday Sabbath, I assure you the devil is going to come after you. We've got a couple in here that have decided to commit themselves to a Saturday Sabbath, and they can back me up on that. But I promise you, he'll send things, obstacles that you will never see coming. But I think once he's lost, you'll get some peace. But again, each person's walk with Christ is between them and Christ. And Nathan's right about that, and I don't want to diminish what he's saying. So that's true, Nathan. That's absolutely true. And John, you know, I was going to today try to come up with a program where we can have multiple speakers and stuff. And man, today was just crazy busy. So we'll try to move in that direction in the near future. Keep the Sabbath. Observe the Sabbath like God asks us to, honey. And what that is we put aside the things of the world. I'd never balance my checkbook on a Sabbath. I'd never count my money. I don't buy things on Sabbath. I try not to go driving around and stuff. I just try to spend my time with God and in study of His Word. And I assure you, if you do these things, He'll honor those. He's our God is amazing. He's good. He's powerful, and He works. Amazing things happen all the time to those that believe. There are those that would try to say, "Oh, it's coincidence" or something like that. But the frequency of the amazing things that happen to those believe it greatly outweighs the frequency of statistical chance. God's real, folks. Of course, everybody here knows that, and he's just an amazing and a good God. Yeah, good thing we got grace, Brycalf. I mean, you know, and you think about that too, because what we owe is our lives, and through His grace, and for no other reason than He loves us and that's what He wants to do. He has at great trouble saved us, He's gone to the trouble. I sure want to take advantage of it, and I think that all of y'all do. No, honey, don't be sorry. That's exactly why we're here, and it's more fun if people are asking questions. If people are not asking questions, I get quiet, but yeah, that's why we're here, and you ask any question that comes on your heart. Like I said, there's no other reason for me to be here. Well, like I said, if you guys quit asking questions and stuff, then this is true. There are people that view that never speak up or never chat, and hopefully you may be asking a question for someone else without even knowing it. And like I said, God works and He does that kind of thing. So, speaking in tongues, according to the scripture, people were. Speaking the word of God in tongues that were unknown to them, and by tongues I mean languages. They did so that people that were in earshot or that were hearing would hear in their native tongues and be amazed, and they were. As far as the modern tongue speaking stuff goes, I don't want to pass judgment on anyone, but I've never been compelled to make noises. I don't want to get on anyone's toes here, but I'm just not convinced. And gosh, Nathan, I don't know. Numbers 11, brief me up just a little bit. I'm about to open my Bible here and look again. But probably not, Nathan. It just depends. I remember vaguely us having a conversation about that. And maybe I did. I don't know. Let's see. Yeah, okay, that's the stories of the quail. I don't know about a deep study. Doesn't the Bible say that all these things will pass? John, see, that's the thing. It does say that at some point that the prophesying and stuff is sealed up, but then again, you know, if you look in... I'm getting my wires crossed. Anyway, it says in the last days God's going to pour out His Spirit on men and stuff, and so it kind of came back. Okay, well now chapter 11 is talking about the quail, Nathan. Towards the end of Naaran, a young man told Moses and said, Eldad and me, Dad, do prophecy in the camp. I'll try to kind of get up to speed on that a little bit later, Nathan. Like I said, I'm sorry, but yeah, I will. I'll look into it. And we're not just doing Friday nights now. We do a Saturday afternoon. And if you're here tomorrow, if I have a chance to look at this, then we'll go over it a little bit tomorrow. Okay, and now I got 2 Corinthians here. Yeah, that's a lot of quail, Brycat. A whole bunch of them. Okay, we got chapter 1 and chapter 13 on Corinthians. Hang on. Chapter 1, 28 and 29. And base things of the world and things which are despised hath God chosen, yea, and things which are not, to bring to naught things that are, that no flesh should glory in his presence. Was there a question about that, Mills? Or were you just wanting to make a point of it? I'm going to make a note of it right now, Nathan, and try to check it out. Yes, sir. Nathan, can you post a link to it? Made a note of it right there if I can find it and remember it. We at 5 p.m. Saturday, Gail, we go on Friday nights, we go from 7 till 9 generally, and then on Saturday afternoon we go from 5 until 7, and like I said, that's right after Sabbath begins and right before it ends. Okay, she's 1 and 18 for the this is 1. For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of God. Amen. Yeah, it's a good verse. Okay, and let me back up John's, I want to say 13. And yeah, 13:8. Headed there, John. charity never faileth, but whether there be prophecies, they shall fail. Whether there be tongues, they shall cease. Whether there be knowledge, it shall vanish away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect is come, then that which is in part shall be done away. When I was a child, I spake as a child, I understood as a child, I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. For now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then shall I know even as also I am known. And now abideth faith, hope, charity. These three, but the greatest of these is charity. Amen. And there's another scripture that mentions charity covering a multitude of sins. And we can talk about that in a moment as well. And yes, John, you made an excellent point. It's a good catch on the scripture. Okay, Nathan, thank you. I'm going to open it over here and put it up where I can check it out later. But let me pause it and make sure it doesn't start. Okay. Hey, it started anyway. Well, John, and that's what it says. And two, but I want you to take a look at the verse 10. Verse 9 says, "For we know in part, and we prophesy in part." But 10 says, "But when that which is perfect is come, then that which is in part shall be done away." Well, that which is perfect. There's some duality there as well, which Christ was perfect, but also the kingdom of God is perfect. And when the perfect is here, the inferior goes away. For example, I don't think anyone was speaking in tongues while Christ was with us. Amos, Nathan can probably correct me, but there's a passage that talks about that he's going to send a famine in the land, and it's not a famine of food, but a famine for hearing the word of the Lord. So we know that. We live in an age of grace, when and how that comes to an end, I'm not exactly sure. I've got some ideas, but, all things are going to come and go, and I think it'll probably be just fine, Nathan. Like I said, I'll check it out. John 9:39, I'll try, Mills, if I know what it means. And Nathan, like I said, Nathan's a man of God, and he knows his Bible. Nathan, if you have something to add, by all means, speak up. Okay, this says, Mills, I'm going to back up and read a couple of verses before just to set us up. Not that it's real important, but and Jesus said unto him, "Thou hast both seen him, and it is he that talketh with thee." I'm talking about the Son of God. And he said, "Lord, I believe," and he worshipped him. And Jesus said, "For judgment I am come into this world, that they which see not might see, and that they which see might be made blind." Well, as you well know, God sent blindness in part upon the Israelites. Who do we have to focus our faith on? Well, it's Christ. He came that those that don't see can see and learn about him. And then those that see, which, makes me easily think of the rabbis to this day. You know, they all claim that Jesus was not the Messiah, and some of them are pretty nasty about it even. And, you know, those were supposedly the men that saw and understood the Word of God, and yet they didn't, and they didn't see. But anyway, you can't go wrong, Nathan. And like I said, a man of your knowledge, I'm sure it's quite an interesting video, and I'm certainly going to check it out. So, yeah, we'll hit that tomorrow if you're able to join us then. Right. You know, and that's another thing that I talked with someone in person about the other day, John. You know, I have heard a lot of people claim that Paul was, you know, a false apostle and blah, 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 that you know, his writings couldn't be trusted and all that sort of stuff. But, you know, one of the easy things that makes me refute that was, I can't think of his name right this second. It starts with an A, Ananias. You know, God told Ananias that he was going to wind up going and seeing Paul. You know, this came from God, and you know, it wasn't just some story that Paul concocted all on his own. Like I said, it did involve Ananias, and Ananias was afraid to go to Paul, and yet, of course, at the urging of the Lord, he did anyway, because he was faithful, I think, and at least in that regard. And yeah, well, you know, and Paul. You've got to understand too, John, that Paul was blind, and then he began to see, not only physically in that blinding that you're talking about on the road, but in as much as a blindness towards the Messiah as well. You know, remember, he said, you know, who are you, Lord? And he said, hey, it's me, the one you persecute. Why do you persecute me, Paul? And anyway, yeah, so, you know, he was given his sight physically and spiritually. Don't worry about it, Cave. We're glad you made it, brother. You know, Ephesians would tend to lean in that direction, Miss Mills. So, you know, at least there's a guarantee, you know. And you know, when you're sealed as one of God's, then it says there's a guarantee. So surely it could be counted at the moment of faith. Like I said, you know, Ephesians says, you know, that at the moment we began to believe that the guarantee was sealed within us. And so then, you know, like I said, once it's sealed, it seems to be over and done. And so I suppose it could be counted from that time. Yes, ma'am. Well, Nathan, we all have those times, and too, I understand, you know, we remember when you got your job, and I'm glad that it's going well for you and all that stuff, and, you know, you get your schedule worked out and, you know, figure out when are the best times for you and stuff. I mean, you know, we have to live. God knows that, and he knows that food's expensive these days, so, you know, I know he hasn't forgotten his son, Nathan. Well, like I said, I agree with that, Mills. You know, that's the first time I've ever really kind of examined the theory. But, you know, in thinking on it, I kind of agree with that without any problem. Well, we want everybody to talk, Caveman, and ask questions. That's how we get out the information that folks want or need. We read the book of Ruth a little bit earlier, Cave. Sorry you missed that, but we'll try to read something else before the night's out. Well, we've already gone an hour and 21 minutes, so let's, like I said, we'll go wherever you guys want to go. This is y'all's time. We've got about 40 minutes left, so you know, if y'all want me to read something, I'll be happy to. Or if you just want to chat ask questions, we'll do that as well. Like I said, this is for y'all, and I enjoy doing it, so it's not a problem. Amen.
God is good, and Jesus is coming. And there was something that I was going to read for you guys, but it was a week or so ago, and I have no idea what it was right now. I'll try to check them out, Nathan. Like I said, I'm quite interested in, and I know what a good fellow you are, so I'll check them out. I'm glad you gave me a link so I can be sure to find your particular channel, and it be the right one. Oh, excuse me, guys. Had a busy, long day. Anybody got a favorite story or anything y'all want to talk about before we move on? Or where we're going to move on to? Yes, Mills, I believe so. It's okay, Cave. I mean, I'm sorry that you missed the first part, but we're glad you made it. Hang on, let me look at your scripture there, Mills, and then we'll try to answer your question. It's all the same thing as far as rapture stuff goes. It's all kind of hinges on what I'm about to talk about. It says, the scripture seems to indicate that there will be natural born humans born into the millennial reign. And if the rapture was at the second coming, then everybody would have their glorified bodies prior to the millennial reign. And who would be left to produce natural-born humans? However, if the pre-tribulation rapture is correct, which I do believe it to be for many, many, many biblical reasons, not the least of which is no groom beats the bride before the wedding. But with the pre-tribulation rapture, then it still allows for natural-born humans that survive and save through the tribulation to be producing offspring well into the millennium. And in no other context can I see that working out. So, Mills, I think that after the rapture, some will be saved. And I believe that Scripture agrees with me there. And then that's just kind of where I stand from what I've learned. But anyway, now Luke chapter 15, 4 and 6, or just 6, or well, I'll read starting with 4. What man of, this is the words of Jesus, by the way. What man of you, having 100 sheep, if he lose one of them, does not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after that which is lost until he find it? And when he hath found it, he layeth it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he cometh home, he calleth together his friends and neighbors, saying unto them, rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep which was lost. Amen. The Bible does not say the earth is flat. The Bible talks about the klug, which is a sphere. If you post that again, you'll be banned. That's preposterous and just wholly ignorant. I'm a pilot. I've been high enough to see the curve of the earth, and it's just completely ridiculous. The shadows on the face of the earth will prove that the earth is round. Look at the shadow of the earth on the moon during an eclipse. It's round. Man, well, that just lights me up. That's ridiculous. (Clears
I mean, look at the rest of the planets. You blow a bubble, what shape does it turn? Does it turn into a saucer or does it turn into a sphere? Come on. Her eyes are half a bubble off level. Okay, now, I'll get my blood pressure back down. Yeah, you can't read, I don't think. Get out of here. Man. It's ridiculous. And two, you know, just for you guys' edification, you can take three dry wells that are not real close to one another and measure the sunlight. Wait till the sun illuminates the one in the middle and measure the angle of the sunlight on the others, and it clearly displays a curved earth. That's just ridiculous. Yeah, thanks, John. They put a dome over the earth. Who put a dome over there? They, you know, these people, they claiming that man did. It's just so ridiculous. Come on, grow up. Man, preposterous. Okay, anybody, where y'all want to go from here? I don't remember what we were talking about before that ridiculousness. Yeah, I know, Cave. Unfortunately. I've had so many, you know, like I said, I have seen the curve of the earth, and I've had so many people try to convince me it's flat. I'm like, come on. It's ridiculous. Amen, Nathan. Yeah, I know, John. Yeah. I hope they punished him. Gail, read that very carefully. It's very interesting because if you'll notice that it never rained before the flood came. Scripture seems to indicate that there was a mist that it emanated up from the earth that watered the plants. And myself and some others believe that there was a vapor canopy in our atmosphere that help protect us from the sun rays and stuff. I believe that the environment was different and probably more conducive to healthier, longer lives in those days. I believe that water above that was broken was the moisture canopy that we talk about. And I'll go ahead and stick my neck out a little bit further. I believe that when Noah's flood happened, that it was, of course, we know that it was certainly God's will and His hand, but I think the tool that He used was another planetary body coming near the Earth, and some even say an impact or something, but I think that's how the water above that you're talking about was broken up, like I said, it, you know, after that event, that's when we got the current hydrological cycle that we have, you know, with the rains and stuff. Before that, the water came up from the ground. It's all very, very fascinating, and I highly recommend everyone read it. Like I said, it's really, really fascinating, and if you examine it closely with an open heart and an open mind, science is starting to bear out all the truth in the scriptures, and it's just remarkable. It's just remarkable. I'd like to hear it, Nathan, and that's what we were just talking about. I believe you're somewhat right about that, Nathan. You know, and there are a lot of very, very, very smart scientists that would agree with you. So, like I said, I don't have any problem with that, and that's one of the things that I really look forward to about heaven, is
we get to learn those things. But as far as talking on here, I'm reticent, not reticent. I'm lax or lazy. I haven't gotten it set up yet, but we have talked about it before about the participants being able to come on screen and speak and stuff. And I intended to do that today, and I had about 10 things that I did not expect to have to do had come down the pipe. So today was busy, but I'll try to make some leeway in that direction where we can have other folks on, and hopefully we're going to have a guest or two sometime in the future. Well, yeah, there are levels, and Paul talked about it a little bit as well, Gail. Many years ago, I'm not sure which one. I want to say it was either the Genius of Vilna or Maimonides, but one of them studied just the first chapter of Genesis for months on end. When he concluded his study, they asked him what he learned, and he said that there are at least 10 dimensions. 4 are knowable, 6 are unknowable. And science seems to be about to bear that out too. And like I said, this came from 1,000 years ago. But, the 4 dimensions that we have, that we know, are length, width, height, and time. And then there seems to be 6 other dimensions that we don't and cannot know. And like I've said before, it's a whole nother subject, and I won't run off into it. But, these aliens and UFOs, they're not interstellar travelers. They're interdimensional travelers. They're the fallen angels or minions or offspring of the fallen angels, and they're moving between dimensions, not between planets. Like I said, most all of y'all know that I'm an ex-United States Air Force aerospace tech, and I'm not a genius or anything, but I have looked at this in a practical, plausible light, and I have come to the conclusion that interstellar travel will probably never be possible, and it's certainly impossible, completely 100% impossible as we know it now. And you think about the distances to be traveled and stuff. Think about it like this: for an alien to come from as far away as they claim that they have come, they would have had to leave home 20,000 years ago. Well, personally, I don't believe man was on Earth 20,000 years ago. Then they would have had to come here knowing what was going to happen while they're on the way. It's just ridiculous. It's not possible. UFOs and aliens and stuff, they're not from other planets. They're from other dimensions. Yep, they're demons. That's right, John. And amen, Mills. Jesus gave his life. Jesus was big, but that's, I don't care who you are, if you lay down your life for your friends, that's quite a statement, and blessed be his name. It's amazing. Look how many he did it for, and if there had have been just one, I think he would have done it anyway. Praise the Lord. Amen. Absolutely. Like I say, I see things all the time that testify of the goodness and the power of God, and I know that he is absolutely with us at every step, just as though Mills said it. Believe and you'll be rewarded. It's amazing. Like I said, the people that don't believe, God's not going out of his way for them, but for those that believe, man, get out of the way. I once had a guy coming in the shop giving us
problems. And my business partner was a big believer too. And the guy left, and my partner's like, "What are you going to do about that?" And I told Gerald, I said, "Man, I said the only thing I haven't done about that is pray on it, and I kind of hate to do that to the man." And he just laughed and walked away. He knew exactly what I was talking about, and I think many of y'all do too. God, we're glad you made it, Paul. And yeah, God's watching, and God loves us, and for the faithful few, he'll go out of his way. Put your trust in Jesus, and sit back and be amazed. Happy Sabbath, Paul. Amen, Nathan. That's what I'm talking about. It's just, he's incredible. And Gail, that's very kind of you. Thank you very much. And I just hope you enjoy your time here, and I hope you you come back and join us again regularly. Right, Mills. You know, a lot of y'all, I'm sure, have heard Chuck Missler talk about plank length. You know, and that's plank is named after the scientist, I believe, but. Plank length, it seems to be that it's negative 10 to the 33rd meters, very, very, very tiny length of measure of length that we're talking about, but nothing in this reality can be smaller than that. You know, and the way Chuck describes it is if you took a string and cut it in half, then you cut that in half, and you cut that in half, you would think that, you know, as long as your blade was thin enough that you could continue to do that infinitely. But no, there is a lower limit, and that is plank length, or negative 10 to the 33rd meter. And like I said, it's a tiny, tiny, tiny microscopic slice. But if you attempted to cut it any shorter than that, then it loses a physical property of its location. And then that leads us into quantum entanglement and a lot of other things that, you know, is again more evidence of the hand of God in the reality that that we inhabit. And yeah, this world, I mean, everything, it's incredible. For example, if you take a hydrogen atom, you know, it's got a nucleus and a single electron orbiting the nucleus, and you know, particle physicists can explain that, you know, as the two particles. But then, you know, if we look at the hydrogen molecule, that we see that entire space, all the space of the electron as hydrogen. And in reality, what we actually have is two particles. So y'all probably hear that insect outside my window buzzing. What we have is just two particles, and the rest of the space is vacant. And, you know, if we blew that up to the electron was about the size of a ping pong ball or so, excuse me, the nucleus was about that size, the electron would be orbiting it at something like a 3-mile radius. And so what you've got are two particles in all this empty space, yet it behaves as a solid thing taking up all that space. It's the work of God. This is an artificial reality, and he's preparing us for the real reality, which is the kingdom of God. And it's just amazing. You know, if you take a ratio between the difference in the amount of hard particles in matter versus the empty space that's in matter, the ratio would be the same as 1 second compared to 30 million years. Now, you think about that. You know, in other words, you go outside tomorrow and you put your hand on your car, realize what you've got your hand on is less than a thimble full of particles behaving in such a way that you recognize an automobile. It's just amazing. Yeah, he was right out near by the window, John, and he was quite loud. It's probably a cicada. They make lots of noise, but I don't know. It didn't really sound like a cicada, but it didn't sound like a cricket either, so I don't know what it was. But it's warm here now, and I have the window open and a little bitty fan
blowing. Well, it's just some interesting stuff, Cave, and you know, it's not really a salvation specific. It's just demonstrates the power of God and you know, and the reality in which we live, and the temporariness of this reality. It stopped now, Nemo. Like I said, you know, we know that where God lives is the real reality, and where we live is the creation that, or the garden is the way I like to look at it. I like to look at us as His garden, and you know, He uses the same metaphors in harvest. Anyway, yeah. Well, and too, Mills, that's something I was talking to someone just recently about also, is that science, every little advancement it makes, it brings it closer to the truth that's written in the scriptures. And it's becoming some very, very uncomfortable territory for some scientists. And I can't remember all the guys. Robert Jastrow, I know John knows who he is. He was a scientist, and one of the things he wrote, and I'll mess the quote up, but it's beautiful. He says, you know, the scientist that has struggled, you know, all of his life up the peak of scientific knowledge, when he finally hauls himself right, you know, over the peak, you know, to find that ultimate truth, he finds a band of theologians who've been sitting there for centuries. And in other words, he's saying, you know, that men of the scriptures have known the truth forever, and that the scientists are going to get there and be a little bit disappointed. But yeah, it's amazing. And actually, Nathan, again, I think that you're absolutely right. I think that it's the resonance of God's voice. I think that's where the human resonance comes from. I think it's the resonance from God's voice, and when He spoke the universe into existence, I think that resonant power affected everything. It's God's amazing. Caveman, have you seen the movie God of Wonders? If you haven't, you've got to see it. It's really, really good. You'll really like it. You'll really understand it. It's awesome. It's amazing. And I recommend everybody see that movie, God of Wonders. I'll put a link up for it. Let me pull up a link and put it up. It's a great movie. And it demonstrates a lot of God's power in the world in which we live. It's awesome. Yeah, I know a lot of y'all have seen it, but those that haven't, by all means, watch it. It's incredible. Great movie. I mean, me and my wife have seen it a lot of times, and if any of you guys showed up and said you wanted to see it, we'd probably happily sit down and watch it with you again. It's a really, really, really good movie. There it is. It's an hour and a half, Gail. It's free on YouTube, and I recommend that you watch it with the biggest screen and the best sound system you got. This movie will blow you away. It's awesome. If you love God, you'll love that movie. It's amazing. It really is. And it's got some of my favorite scientists of the book as well. Jason Lyles from the Creation Research Institute is in there, and a couple of others that I really like. It just really is. I can't say enough good about that movie. It's a great movie. And I recommend you all watch it if you haven't seen it. Yes, amen. Well, you know, you guys talking about that, it makes me think of that verse that I have up. I can put it up. I think I got it on the moon here. I'm going to take a quick look, let y'all see it here. Yeah. Matthew 13:16-17. It says, "But blessed are your eyes, for they see, and your ears, for they hear.
For verily I say unto you, that many prophets and righteous men have desired to see those things which you see, and have not seen them, and to hear those things which you hear, and have not heard them. Amen. Amen. I'll leave it up there just a second. Okie dokie. Well, we're at about an hour and 50 minutes, folks. Leaves us about 10 or 15 more minutes this evening. And if you've got any questions or anything on your mind, let's get it out. And if not, we'll move on into our prayer here in a little bit. We've got also, again, too, we've got quite a few names on the prayer list. And if anybody needs to add a name, now would be the time. Wow, this list is growing and it's getting so long. I almost want to take people off that don't need prayers, but everybody needs prayers, and so we'll just power through, I guess. And yeah, to, of course, God loves us all, but we've had some really good reports from some of the folks that we've been praying for, and I don't know that it has anything to do with it, but I like to believe that God hears us and loves us and has honored those folks with His grace and mercy. Anybody know of anybody that needs to be on the prayer list? Can I take you off? Well, I can. You don't want us to pray for you? And let's see, Mills, I've got you and Jessica. And it seems like I got like maybe your granddaughter or grandson on there. Like I said, I don't really want to take you off. I mean, gosh, it's not any problem. We'll just leave you on there. You study so much. You need some grace. Yeah, I'm not looking to cut anybody. I was just saying, you know, the list is growing so long. But, yeah, there's no need in taking folks off. We got you and Rose on here, Paul, and I ain't going to take you guys off. Like I said, I'm not looking to take anybody off. I was really just making a joke. I'll show you all a quick shot of the list. It's growing into a nearly a page. We don't... like I said, there's just no need to take anyone off. Okay. Of course, Nate, it's good that everyone else knows that what your request is. You know, we just kind of bring the names up before the Lord, and I know, as you know, that He knows what we all need before we ask, Janet's got a special request for her son. He's may have to move with his work, and I think that would be taking her grandchild further from her, and so that's a great concern of hers, and she's hoping that does not materialize. If Janet's still here, she can tell me her son's name, but I think all I got was son. But I'll put her son there. And anyway, Namo, do you know somebody that needs a prayer? Or are you just... thinking about poor Janet and her grandbaby, what I'm guessing. Do do you want me to say your last name every time, Karen? I generally use first names. I can use your last name, but you know, since it's the oh, got you, Namo. And since it's the web, you may or may not want us to use the whole name, but I'm certainly going to write it down. And if you decide you don't want me to use it, then we'll mark it out. I know that God knows who you are, sweetie. And we're glad you're here, Miss K. Smith. Amen, Gail. My brain's a little bit rusty at the moment, but I'll think of some things for you and Nathan, because there are some really hard-hitting points that point at God, and sometimes when they're exposed to non-believers properly, it sets forth a little bit of growth, and so maybe we can help each other and you know, give y'all some talking points, because you know, as we all know, God is real, His Word is real, and it's been more accurate than anything else this earth has ever produced. So I think I'll stick with it. And K. Smith, you're very, very welcome, and we're glad you're here, and we hope that you come back. And yeah, I'm marking out your last name so we're not advertising you on the web. And anybody else? Anybody got anything? And if not, I'll try to read a little bit of something here. We still got a few minutes. I'll tell you what. We'll hit something. Very, very last verse in Isaiah. This is something that personally I find pretty interesting. And well, I'm going to read the last two verses in the book of Isaiah. It's Isaiah chapter 66. I'm going to begin with verse 23. And it says, "And it shall come to pass that from one new moon to another, and from one Sabbath to another, shall all flesh come to worship before me, saith the Lord. And they shall go forth and look upon the carcasses of the men that have transgressed against me, for their worm shall not die, neither shall their fire be quenched, and they shall be an abhorring unto all flesh." Well, you go ask a preacher, ask a bunch of preachers, what does that mean? And you're going to get all kinds of crazy answers. But let's flip back to Psalm 22. And it's going to be a little more clear for us after that. Psalm 22. This is clearly, now this was written roughly 1,000 years before crucifixion of Christ. And if you'll notice, the first words of this psalm is what Christ said on the cross. And he said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Well, I don't think any of y'all believe that God forsook Christ. He didn't forsake him. Christ was saying, look, what you guys are seeing is Psalm 22 playing out before your very eyes. Well, let me read over it real quick. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? Why art thou so far from helping me and from the words of my roaring? Oh my God, I cry in the daytime, but hearest not, and in the night season, and am not silent. But thou art holy, O thou that inhabitest the praises of Israel. Our fathers trusted in thee, they trusted, and thou did deliver them. They cried unto thee, and were delivered. They trusted in thee, and were not confounded. And then we get to the verse that Jesus says, but I am a worm, and no man, a reproach of men, and despised of the people. Now we go back and look at the last verse in Isaiah, and we realize our worm has died for us. Their worm, not so much. But also, there's another beautiful message in that, in as much that worm. If any of you guys are taking notes, highly recommend you to Google, look up the scarlet worm. This is a worm that Christ was fully aware of. Red dye was made from it in his day. The scarlet worm When it was ready to produce offspring, it would find a suitable spot on a shrub oak in Israel, and it would climb that tree, and it would fasten itself to that tree so permanently it would never leave again. Its body there, fastened to the tree, protecting its offspring, and when the offspring were ready to go away and live lives of their own, they did. The mother died, and she left a red stain on that tree, a blood-red stain on that tree. And after 3 days, that stain turned white as snow and smelled like perfume. Amen. It's a beautiful picture of what Christ did. He used his body to shield his children. He died on that cross and turned our red, scarlet sins white as snow. Amen. And it's like I said, the scripture explains itself. We just have to know where to look and how to read it. And amen. Well, Nathan, like I said, we all have our troubles and our temptations and obstacles and stuff. But don't turn away from the Lord. I see you clinging to the Lord and striving to reach Him or be closer to Him, and that's what He wants. Just hang in there and do your best and I'm sure He recognizes. Well, we've gotten pretty close to the end of our evening, and we're going to say a word of prayer, and we're going to lift up our friends to the Lord, those that are in need of comfort, mercy, and healing. And then hopefully again we'll see you guys all tomorrow. As usual, after the session, I will cut the stream long enough for it to reset. Y'all can chat all you want, and I will restart the stream so that chatters can come and go as they please afterward. And again, like I said, I'll be looking forward to seeing you guys tomorrow. So let's bow our hearts, give a word of thanks to our wonderful God. And I hope everybody has an excellent Sabbath, and I hope to see you all again tomorrow. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. May your kingdom come and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Please forgive us our sins as we forgive those that sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Father, we're so lucky, we're so grateful to know you, to know your Son, Yeshua, Jesus Christ, the one who gave his life to save us. Father, we're so grateful for this Sabbath day that we have time to fellowship, friends to fellowship with, and your word to study on. Father, we're so grateful. There's just no word in our language that can cover the gratitude. Father, we love you. We're so grateful. And we would like to lift up our friends that are in need of your mercy and your comfort and your healing. Father, you know their needs. You know who they are. And we'd like to hold them up to you, Father. Their names, as we know them, are Crash, Christine, Hayward and Guy, Paul and Rose, Wesley, Serena and Brett, Janet and her son, Mills and Jessica, Caveman, Dew, Lyrek, Chrissy, Haley, Dave, Joseph, Georgie, Brendan and Bella, Eva, Lori, Valerie, Jordan and Hannah, Jessica, Lynn, James, Christian, Karen, Debbie G, Donna, Christopher, Rob and Sharon, Bri Cat, Liz, Mandy, Shirley, Kimberly, Edric K, Richard, Blue, Susan, Norma, George, Laura and Tony, Jacob, Anyar, Justin, Tristan, Caden, Christine, Christy, Joe P., and our brother Nathan. Father, you know their needs. They love you, they cling to you, and they long for your help. And we know that you will help them in your way, in your will. Father, we thank you. We're so grateful. We love you so much. And we long for you to be with us in our walk. In Jesus' name, amen. Ladies and gentlemen, He's coming soon. This earth is playing out and timing out, and he's wanting to spread the word, and that's why we're here. Anybody that needs a Bible, let me know. I think most of you have one. If you don't, by all means, speak up. Let me know, and we'll try to take care of that. Okay. Hey, Max, good to see you, and glad you're here. And Melissa, we're glad you came. Thanks for coming. Gail, it's wonderful. All you new folks, I'm really, really glad you're here. Hope to see you again. I hope you had a good time. And a lot of times we have a lot of fun, so keep coming. And amen, Susan. And if you have questions throughout the week during your studies and stuff, by all means, write them down, bring them here, and we'll all answer them together, and we'll all learn together. And happy Sabbath, everyone. Thank you, Paul. Paul, give Rose my regards, and I hope to talk to you guys again soon. And thank you for coming, guys. Y'all are a blessing to me. I really, really appreciate you coming. And I'm going to cut the stream now. Like I said, y'all stay in chat, and then as soon as I restart it, you'll be able to come and go without any problem. Be 5 p.m., Miss K. Smith, tomorrow. On Saturdays, it's 7 till 9, and on Fridays, it's 7 till 9, and Saturdays, it's 5 till 7. And hopefully, we'll see you then. And I love all of you guys. Y'all are all great, and thanks for coming. And amen. Amen, Mills. Okay, I'm going to cut the stream, guys. Y'all can still chat. Don't leave until I start it back so you can get back in. And God bless you all. And we'll talk to you soon. And I'll probably come back and chat here in just a little while. Take care, guys. God bless you. Happy Sabbath. Thanks for coming.